And welcome to Arguing the Toss from GameIndustry.com. I'm Chella.
And I'm Drew, and together we're arguing about the things that really matter in games.
Indeed. And today we have a guest with us, our overlord and eminent editor, John Breeden.
Hi.
Welcome, John.
Oh, absolutely. Good to be here. Space Cadet Breeden reporting for duty.
Exactly. Yeah. We're circling in the stars at the moment, meeting on a space station.
Yeah. Although we can't see each other, apparently.
No, obviously, because the universe is too vast. So, Drew, do you want to introduce this week's topic?
Yeah, as I'm sure some people have already guessed, we're going to be talking about No Man's Sky, which we've all played and we've all got various levels of experience with. And, what is it? Everyone else think of it? Note that I didn't want to start, so I just threw it out to you guys.
Okay.
Sit back.
Well, seeing as John's the guest, John, what are your first impressions of No Man's Sky?
Well, you don't want to know my first impressions, so let me give you my mature impression. So, I mean, I don't know. It's like with No Man's Sky, I like it. Let me just say that. So, I'm glad I'm not doing the review. I'm glad that you're doing the review, Chella, because I have a lot of mixed feelings about the game, I guess you might say. But generally, I like it. So, I mean, when I'm sitting there playing Deus Ex, and I'm thinking about, gosh, I really could, if I just got a little bit more of a chrysanthemum or whatever that mineral is, I could chain my hyperdrives together. That means it has an impression on me. I mean, I like it. It's pretty cool, but I think you have to get into the mindset that it's just kind of like a chill game where, you know, you just kind of sit and explore. It's not really super exciting. I think you're going to bring this up about the hype that was put into it. I think they did a really good job of marketing it in that they didn't really tell us a lot about it. Mm-hmm. So I think a lot of people kind of in their minds, they kind of drew it.
Let's talk about that later when we cover that. So first impressions were you like it and but
you're right, right, okay, but. Good one.
Because I don't want to get into like the whole thing of that, because we'll cover that later in the show. So yeah, I pretty much agree with that. I mean, it's gorgeous, it looks pretty. I was really excited going into it. I got into it like 5 days after everybody else, because I was on the panel at Nine Worlds, so I was away in London, away from my PlayStation 4 when it landed. So I rushed home, downloaded it, the first thing I did on Sunday morning, and I really enjoyed it. I basically sat that first day for like 7 hours straight, and I was just like hooked on it. So yeah, I found it strangely addictive. I was like, there's nothing really happening in this game, but I can't stop playing it. I can feel that beginning to wear off. I mean, it's not perfect by any stretch, but, you know, like you say, we'll talk about the kind of hype and the backlash and stuff later. So
yeah.
Drew, what were your, I think yours, slightly different.
Yeah, well, I sort of saw it, obviously I saw No Man's Sky at the E3 whenever it was announced and everyone sort of went nuts over it, and then I know a lot of other people have done this as well. I looked at it and said, right, I don't want to pay any attention to that, I don't want to know anything, and I'll wait until that comes out. That seems like a really good idea. I'm going to wait, just know nothing about it, and then get it on the day and play it and enjoy it, because I like the idea so much. And so I got it home, I did it. And I don't think I was in the sort of right frame of mind to start it, because I'd just done a long day at work. It's an interesting game, but it's not one that's immediately exciting and immediately accessible. So I had a lot of trouble after work, sort of just putting 3 hours in to get past like the tutorial stuff. So that's my very first impression, was like, oh my God, I can't actually play this anymore. I'm going to... and stuff. So I've gone back to it since, I'm mixed on it. I've got to say, I don't think it's a game for me. You know, I like the idea of it. I like the big open world of it, but the actual sort of gameplay of it, the on the ground gathering resources, inventory management, upgrading all that stuff, that's not really what I was looking for when I first saw like the trailers and first saw all the big world stuff. So
yeah,
I understand that it is it's sort of an amazing technical achievement. It's a really amazing game. Mm-hmm. I know that some people are really into it. It just doesn't hit my buttons.
Yeah.
Which
okay.
is a shame because I really do want to enjoy it.
I feel like that with stuff like Skyrim and Fallout.
Yeah.
That's basically my feeling is like, I want to like those because everybody loves them so much and they are a cool world, but it's like, I just can't be bothered. So, yeah, I get that. I get that.
Yeah.
So John is basically, John's probably the furthest, well, definitely the furthest on of the three of us in the game. So this is like, we're going to do our little guide, I guess, to No Man's Sky, things we learnt from No Man's Sky that might help other travellers on their journeys through space.
These are all the things that really frustrated us that we wish somebody would have freaking told us before we started.
Basically. I basically got one top tip because I'm probably the least, like probably the sort of most beginner because I was like, yeah, started so much later than everybody else. So I've got one. Shall I give my one tip? Just in case you take my tip away from me, John. Or Drew.
Oh, yeah, no, please. Go ahead.
My first tip is that if you're on a hostile planet with radiation, I don't know if it works for cold as well. It's my first planet. I don't know. That's, another thing that might be quite nice to see is, like, how different our experiences were, like, our first planet. My first planet had pretty bad radiation, so I was constantly grappling with that. The sentinels were quite aggressive, so if you mined too much, which, as a gamer, I did. I was like, oh, it says destroy. And I get this stuff, if I destroy it, I'm going to destroy all of that I can see. And then these sentinels came and just like blew me to smithereens. I was like, oh, okay. So don't go with natural gamer kind of. I love that it did that it was like, no, you don't use your natural gamer instinct with this because otherwise this happens. So I really liked that. So that was my initial on the planet, and so I was grappling with this radiation, and I was like, saw some shiny thing in a cave, and I went into the cave, and my suit was like super low. I was like, oh crap, I'm going to die out here. I've been walking for 7 hours. This is going to be really annoying. And I got into the cave, and it's like, radiation levels returning, or something like that. And I was like, yes! So caves protect you from radiation. That's my one tip.
That's pretty cool. They protect you from everything, actually. Heat, cold.
Oh, do they? Yeah. Okay.
Anything. Okay. Yeah.
So caves are awesome, people.
And in a pinch, this is my Bear Grylls tip. You can build your own cave. Just find a big resource thing and mine a little hole in it. You don't have to go that deep. And you just walk into the little like 4 foot cave and your levels
like
will drop as well.
Pyridium or like a big or thing of gold you can just like carve a hole in. That's great. I didn't know that.
Yeah, many years playing survival horror type games, that's like, I'm gonna try this and see if it works, and it did. So I was quite pleased to see that. So although iridium is a radioactive element, I think, so it's kind of weird to build a cave out of it, but it protects you, so it works.
Well, there is a lot of plutonium lying around as well, isn't there?
Yeah.
Oh my god, yeah.
Just everywhere.
So what were your first planets like? Was it a similar experience? Did you?
I was started on a paradise world, really. I mean, temperate. Lots and lots of cool animals. None of them like hostile. So I just assumed they started everybody on an easy world. Man, Shelly, you got a hard experience if you started on a radiated planet.
I got killed in like a minute.
Yeah, that's bad. Drew, what did you start at?
Mine seems to be sort of between the two. I had plenty of radiation, but I didn't have any sentinels attacking me on my first world, which I don't know if I would have been able to deal with that because I hadn't actually yet learned that I had a gun. But,
Oh, really?
Yeah. So mine,
that's interesting.
Yeah.
They don't tell you much.
No, they don't.
No, I quite liked that. I liked that early slap to the back of the head. Don't be such a gamer. And I was like, okay, I'll just take what I need then. So yeah. Oh, that's interesting. So tips, guys. What tips did you got? Because the one thing I want to know is how do you get a freaking Atlas pass? I want and do they make a difference? Like, does it like open the world up for you?
Go ahead,
I have
Drew.
that exact same question. Yes.
Oh gosh, well I have the answer. Okay, to get the Atlas Pass, there's three Atlas Passes in the game, level 1, 2, and 3, which all open doors. And they're backwards compatible. So if you get a 2, you can destroy your Atlas Pass number 1, and if you get a 3, you can
Okay.
destroy 2, because they all take up inventory space, and nothing in this game freaking stacks, which is stupid. But so yes, instead of taking up 3 spaces, if you're lucky enough to get a level 3 pass, you can get rid of 1 and 2. To get 1, all you have to do is when you get into space, you have the ability to follow the path towards the center of the universe, or you have the ability to follow the Atlas path. It's on your map. It's the yellow line or the red line. Follow the red line, and eventually you will come to your first Atlas station, which looks like a regular star station, like a space station, I guess I'm trying to say, except for it's a big diamond, and it'll be red instead of yellow on your when you get to the system. Go in there, you get to talk to Atlas, your first Atlas, which is like a giant red blob thing. It'll tell you a bunch of vocabulary stuff, and will give you your first Atlas path or your first Atlas stone. And then you leave that station. The very next place you warp to, you will detect an anomaly. And in that anomaly, there'll be two weird little. It's another space station, basically. And inside that anomaly, there's two weird little aliens named Polo and Rolo, I think, or something like that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and they give you your first Atlas path. That's how you get the level 1.
Right.
So yeah, just basically just follow the Atlas path. You'll get to the first.
Okay, so we just haven't got there yet. Okay.
Yeah, it's story based basically. Though there you follow the Atlas path, go to your first
Okay.
Atlas interface, and then the very next system you'll meet Polo and Rolo or whatever their names are, and
Okay.
they'll help you. 2 and 3 are randomly given to you when you raid the closed facilities. But I don't know if you have to have level 1 first. I didn't find my level 2 until after I had my level 1. But I don't know if that was, I mean, it's random, so I don't know. So those are the if you go to the beacons, you know, where you have to build the little bypass chip, and it tells you it tells you, you know, one of these four things. Select colonial outposts, and that's the ones that you go to, and the door's locked with steel.
Oh yeah, I've seen a couple of
Yeah.
those.
Oh
Yeah,
yeah.
and you have to blow down the door and then go in and solve the little puzzle.
Yeah.
Those are the ones where you'll randomly get Atlas Pass 2 and 3. And I've heard that when you do that on hostile planets, like ones that have radiation and stuff, you have a higher chance of getting a 2 or 3. I don't know. I found mine on a regular planet, but that's how you get 2 and 3.
All
And
right.
as yeah, and as far as what they do, they open all those Atlas doors. The level 1 pass gives you the ability to go into like I call it the VIP lounge in the in the space stations.
Oh,
whenever you
yeah.
go to a space station, you can go left or right. If you go right, you go to wherever the encounter is, and you can sell stuff and stuff. You go to
Yeah,
the
and then the other door is closed unless you have a
yes.
pass.
You
Yeah.
go in there, and it's like a got a little lounge in there, and
What's in the lounge, John? Is there a bar?
there is there there's a bar. There's like, but there's no people in there usually.
What?
There's
Oh.
plants that
Are there olives?
you can mine. There is the big thing that's in there is the ability to upgrade your suit. So it's like a drop. Yeah, it's like a
Oh.
drop pod. It's inside the space station, so that gives you that.
I was wondering that because the suit has so few
Yeah.
slots.
Oh,
Yeah.
you have to upgrade the suit. I mean, and
Okay,
it's
yeah.
expensive as all heck. It's free the first time, and then it's
Okay.
10,000 plus 10,000 every time you So the next one, the second one costs you 10,000, the third one costs you 20,000, the fourth one costs you 30,000.
Okay, right.
So now when I upgrade my suit, it costs me $320,000. So yeah, it's super expensive. Yeah.
So you can't actually get new exosuits then. You just upgrade the one you have.
Yes.
It's not like ships and multi-tools where you can just pick random ones up.
It's the same old suit that you just keep adding spaces to, which actually brings me to my first and biggest tip, which I want to give to people, and that is link everything. Everything that's a like system needs to be linked together. And that includes your suit, on your multi-tool, and on your ship. Because I didn't know that, so I got really far into the game, and then I realized it, and then I had to uninstall everything and rebuild everything, and it sucked. It took me like 2 days to redo my whole inventory. What I mean is, so your original suit, the only suit that you have, mm-hmm. has core components down the side. So it's got life support, it's got a jetpack, it's got I think that's all it has, actually. But as you
like the scanner and stuff like that.
Well, the scanner's on your multi-tool. On your suit, for example, you have a life support module, a basic life support.
Yeah.
Okay. When you adventure, you will find new life support modules that increase the amount of time that you can spend outside without your life support going down. If you just randomly put them in anywhere, you'll get a benefit from them, but it won't be as much as you think. If you install them beside your original module, so if you have three and they're all connected in a line. Not diagonally, but linearly, they each support each other. So for example, if your regular life support gives you, say, 50, and then this new one will give you another 50, if you install it somewhere else on the suit, you'll have 100 altogether. But if you install them together, then each one, instead of giving you 50, might give you 70. So you install them all in a line, and it works. In the same way with your shield. And when you start getting shields, if you get multiple shields for your suit, you install them together and it gives you a lot more protection. Same way with radiation protection and heat protection and everything else. Your jetpack. Jetpack's a big one. When you get extra jetpack modules, install them all together in a line and you'll be able to practically hover once you get them all installed together. So everything has to be installed together and you can't move them after you install them. So you have to kind of plan ahead. So I leave spaces for like, okay, this is where I'm going to put my extra shield modules basically, you know? And so that's how you have to do it. Yeah.
Oh, right. Yeah. I completely missed that. Yeah.
Yeah.
The big one is on your ship. The ship system should go together. So, like, your shields on your ship will link as well. So link your shields up, and that'll protect you from the pirates big time. Like, I have I have four shields, and they're all linked. So the pirates, they can't hardly even make a dent on my ship because they never get through my shields. But the big one is the hyperdrives. You have your hyperdrive, and then you have your warp engines. You have to chain those together because later on in the game, as you get closer to the center of the universe, if they're not chained together, you won't have enough power to get to the next system that you need. So at some point, they need to be chained together, or you won't be able to make a big enough jump to get to other stars. So do that.
Okay, that's a big one. How did you find that out? Did somebody tell you, or did you like stumble?
I noticed in my suit. I noticed that one of the things, the only thing the game will do is when you put them together, it will draw a colored line around both of the components. And I noticed, oh my gosh, I said, that one's got a purple line around. These two have a purple line around it and they're sitting together. And then I asked Michael Blaker because he plays the game. He told me, you need a chain.
Because he is like the lord of the universe.
And then I went through where I'm going to quit this effing game because I looked at my suit and I'm like, God. I have to uninstall like all the stuff and then I have to gather the resources and rebuild it and everything. So
so you have to like dismantle because you can't move stuff around.
Yeah, I hate that.
It's really annoying that it says stack these items, but it won't stack.
Don't.
I mean, so like I was going to ask, you know, the slots as a gameplay mechanic. How are we finding that?
The,
you know, yeah. the limiting factor that they've tried to put in.
I mean, this is what I was saying about when I started playing. I'm not a fan of the sort of moment-to-moment gameplay, because the whole premise of it is that there's this good, you know, it's generating all these gorgeous planets, these gorgeous environments, and I seem to spend most of my time just, like, looking very focusedly on the little menus and fiddling, just transferring one thing from one thing to another. Oh, no, I haven't got any room on my ship now, so now I've got to get this, and yeah. So I feel like I'm focusing on the one thing and missing all the cool stuff.
You're in the janitor
yeah,
closet.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know why they did it that way. It almost, I mean, it almost seems like a mechanic that you would use if your game wasn't long enough to artificially extend the gameplay. And that's obviously not the case here, so I don't know what the thing is. And then for me, from a logical point of view, I don't understand why I can have 250 tons of gold in one slot on my ship and one fascination bead in the second slot. It's weird.
Oh god, those fascination beads. I'd forgotten about those. I haven't had any since my first plan. I was just like, I don't know what the hell these things do. They are going.
Oh yeah, they're technically trade goods, but they if you put enough of them together, you can create an electron gas, which then lets you create antimatter, which then lets you fill your hyperdrive back up.
Okay. But this, okay. So I was going to go off on a crazy tangent then, but I won't. So, and getting more slots is basically just get a bigger ship, get a better multi-tool.
It's getting, as far as I understand it, it's getting that, getting drop pods and that Atlas Pass V1. Apparently you can, that's when you can upgrade your suit, which I assume means adding an extra slot or two.
I have over 30 slots in my suit at this point. I think 28 or something like that.
Oh, luxury.
Yeah, but you can upgrade your suit anytime you want. You don't need the Atlas Pass for that. The Atlas Pass gives you access to the way to upgrade it from the space stations. But just on any planet, you look for the drop pods. They're like little triangles that are sitting there, and then you upgrade. The first one's free, so definitely find it, and it'll give you an extra slot. And then you just keep buying it, and you keep buying more slots, and you can go.
What, just from the trade, the galaxy trade?
No. You have to actually find a drop pod. Special thing. It looks like the little Slee Stack pyramids from Land of the Lost, if anybody's as old as me. But they're basically just like little triangles, and they sit if you're in your ship and you do a scan. I don't know if you guys know this or not, but you know, you do a scan from inside your ship while you're hovering. It will show you the little question marks of where you can go. So one of those is going to probably be a drop pod somewhere if you'll find.
Okay.
So you can upgrade your suit. It's just expensive as hell. I think Michael figured out. He added them all up, and I think to get your maximum suit, you have to spend I think over $7 million altogether.
Wow.
Well, it's 10,000 more every time, so it's expensive quick. But it's helpful. Yeah. It's helpful. I mean, I have, like I say, I have 28 slots, and I still don't have enough, you know, so.
Yeah. Okay, so shall we talk about the hype a little bit, seeing as we were talking about the disappointing sort of slots mechanic thing. So yeah, that's like things I learned from No Man's Sky is that hype is a double-edged sword. I mean, the trouble with this game was it was just so massively, hugely anticipated, and that it could never live up to the hype in a million years. You know, even if it was a brilliant game, I think it would have been hard for it to, and it does. I mean, it is gorgeous, and it's a technical feat. You know, it's like a thing of wonder when you actually sit and think about what it's doing. You know, like how huge it is, and you know how you can land on the planets and take off, and the language thing, and which I love. I love that aspect of it, and I think, you know, it's like. There's a thing of the marketing and gamers are almost sort of equally to blame, and you know, there was this kind of hysteria, and then people not really listening to what they said, you know, because there's been such a huge backlash. I was really surprised.
Well,
but,
in some instances,
people are getting refunds after like 60 hours of gameplay and like ridiculous things.
Well,
and...
in the gamers' defense, though, it wasn't necessarily that they were not listening, although I'm sure that's part of the case. I think in some of the cases, the developers were actually lying about some of the features. I mean, especially the multiplayer. I mean, because they basically said that you'd be able to meet other people, and that is not the case. I mean, I think that was an outright lie. I think that was a feature they thought they were going to add later, and they never got around to doing it.
Right. I mean, I never thought that No Man's Sky was going to be a multiplayer game.
No. I mean, that was definitely my sort of sense. Like I say, I deliberately didn't pay a lot of attention to the marketing.
No, me either.
From the beginning, the launch trailer, as I recall it, and this is a very vague old recollection, was like, oh, it's this massive, you know, massive universe which is the same for everybody, and everybody's going to be doing the same journey towards the center of the galaxy. And that language suggested very strongly to me that it would be a multiplayer game. If everyone is making the same journey, then you'd expect to be able to see other people making it.
Well, the way I saw, well, because they always said, yes, you can see other people, but it would be highly unlikely because there are, like, what, 3 quintillion or whatever it
and
is.
And also we have not programmed that functionality into the game.
Oh, is it not there? I mean,
but
it's kind of like it's moot anyway because the chances of meeting someone are so small.
I don't think the chances are as moot as they say because I've already run into two other players where I've run into planets that other players have named star systems that people have named. If you go to the galaxy map, you can click a button that says search for achievements or search for named things, and you can see in your area. And when I first started playing the first day, there was nothing. There no nothing in my in my area. But now, but now I'm finding a lot of planets that other people have named and stuff. So I think the world isn't
I'm
as big
saying...
as they say it was.
Okay. I mean, but I'm not saying they didn't do any, you know, there wasn't some obfuscation, because I think there was. I think they were kind of cagey about some things when you watch Sean being interviewed. And it almost seems like, I mean, I don't know, because I don't know the guy. So, I mean, to me, it seemed like he almost just didn't want to spoil it, as opposed to he was actually hiding something and... I mean, that's how it appeared to me, that he was just, he was kind of like, yeah, well, in theory. It was almost like it was a guessing game of charades or something, you know, it's like animal, vegetable, or mineral or something like that. And it's like, can you see people? Yeah. And you could tell that there was a caveat there.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it was him, like, purposefully, you know, just like... not wanting to say he didn't want to reveal the whole game before he wanted people to experience it
but in another
rather than trying to misconstrue.
Well, in another instance though, they did say that it would be like what's that game that you really like, Chella, with the sand, the two people
Journey.
Yeah, they said it would be like there would be some sort of a journey like interface if
yeah,
the two
I mean,
people got together. And that's not the case. I mean, it's just not there.
Right, yeah. I mean, that is the impression I got, that, you know, you might see people passing, you know, you might just pass by, your paths might cross.
Michael has actually encountered where other people were, he was with other people, and the only thing that happened was they weren't there, and if he tried to upload a planet that the other guy had already named, and the game crashed because he was trying to upload a planet that had already been named. But on his game, it wasn't already named. Like, the other guy must have done it like a minute before him or something like that. And then he just kind of uploaded and it crashed. So I don't know.
Yeah.
That's the one part where I think the developers just assumed because the world was so big that nobody would get together and that they would implement this feature later. And I just don't think they've gotten it yet.
Yeah, I mean, you have to remember, like, this is a team of 11 people, and it's incredible what they've done.
Sure.
And so I just feel like the backlash is just unnecessary.
Well, I think people, I think I don't think they were clear enough about what the game was beforehand. There is an argument to be made that, yeah, they want to preserve some of the mystery. But but stuff like, oh, you won't actually be able to see other people in the game, that's not preserving vagueness. That's not preserving mystery.
No.
That's just not being upfront about
yeah.
You know, about the content of the game. And as I say that, I don't want to sort of accuse the developers of deliberately misleading. Like, the quotes that people are coming up with that said, oh, they promised this would be in the game, they promised that would be in the game, they are from quite a while ago now, and the game was still very much in development then, and the development cycle just works like that. You know, games change up until, like, just before release. And in the No Man's Sky patch notes and they were saying that the game changed quite significantly in the couple of months before the release. So I don't think they had plans to implement different features which didn't actually make it into the game. It's just that sort of multiplayer is such a big one that you'd think they would have said, there was that one interview where he said, oh, this is a single player experience, don't expect it to be heavily multiplayer. But I still think that was an important piece of information, and I think people bought the game on the assumption that there would be more player interaction than there is.
It's going to be like Destiny or something. Yeah, because, I mean, there's a guy at our role-playing group who, Nate, he was like, you know, it's going to be amazing, it's going to be like Destiny or whatever. He said something. I was like, I don't think it's a multiplayer game. And he's like, yeah, it is.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, I'm pretty sure it's a single-player space. Like, pretty much when I loaded up the game, it was what I expected.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, the actual gameplay of it, yes, but I definitely was, like, maybe this is on me, maybe it's my fault, but I just don't feel that I was informed that it wasn't a multiplayer game. I had to really go looking for that piece of information.
Okay, yeah, I mean, yeah, I was expecting a pretty much a single-player game, and there might be, you know...
See, I think...
You might come across someone.
I think that's part of the problem with it for me, is that because the universe is randomly generated or procedurally generated from one number, I'm not that interested in it. I can visit a randomly generated planet and I can think, oh, this is like quite nice looking. It's got some interesting animals and interesting stuff. But I'm not actually that interested in it unless there was a design behind it, unless, you know, if there's a story behind it, or if there's something particularly interesting that someone has said, all right, we'll put this here and, you know, the player can experience this.
I just saw the new Star Trek movie, and there's a perfect quote in that movie where Captain Kirk is, he's disappointed. He's like bored, basically, because he'd been out in space for 3 years at the beginning of the movie. And he says something to the effect of, like, if space is really infinite and it goes on forever and there's it's you know, completely infinite, then really, what the heck are we doing out here? Why does it matter?
Yeah. I very much agree that I am like Captain Kirk in this scenario. But yeah, so the thing that I was interested in was exploring this with other people and just, you know, when you're on your own, it just feels sort of very lonely, which is part of it, and it's part of what it's going for, but it just doesn't appeal to me, just one person in a massive universe that wasn't really designed, that doesn't really matter, you know, on a story level or on an environmental level.
Yeah.
That's the main thing I'm not sort of gelling with about it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Multiplayer.
Yeah. There is kind of a story if you explore the languages, which I've noticed, which is interesting. Like Shell was mentioning about the languages, there are actually three different languages in the game, one for each of the three main races. And as you follow the languages, it doesn't matter, like, but when... you get the story from the big atlases, the big statues, not the little ones. The little ones just give you words, but the ones where you actually go up to the monument and it gives you like a little puzzle, and if you solve the puzzle right, you get a story element from each of those three races, and it's interesting. Like the birds, the little bird people, like I thought they were the coolest, so I like, oh, they're cool.
I haven't met them yet.
Oh, they're awesome. They're like little traders. They like to trade stuff. And
oh yeah, I think I've run into one of them.
Yeah, and they can they can make different smells. Like if they like you, it'll smell really good, and if they hate you, it'll smell really bad. Yeah, so I thought, oh, they're so cute and everything, but when I started to get into their story, they're actually agents of.
Oh, don't spoil.
Well, they're just not as nice as you might think, and you find that you find that out reading the thing. Although it might be skewed from the perspective of another race story. So
Yeah.
I mean, there is some story in there, Drew. It's just you kind of have to plod along and find it.
Yeah, I'm gonna do that now. I seem to have missed the Atlas path quite sort of significantly so far. I've just been randomly bumming around on planets and. That's the thing.
I've just been bumming around space.
It's not the Atlas interface. I misspoke. It's the big monuments. So the way to find those.
The ruins.
Yeah, the ruins.
Yeah. That's my thing in this is like finding out. I'm like some sort of curator of a museum. That's how I like to think of myself. So I'm going for all the artifacts to get as much language sort of doing the sort of flora and fauna.
So if you're on your ship, if you're flying in the planetary interface and you hit scan, it will scan out an area and then you just go to those little question marks. And some of those won't ever.
Yeah.
Or go to one of those beacons and scan for ancient monoliths.
Yeah.
And that's how you can get the story. But
the monoliths
the sucky part is if you're on like a planet that's a Covex planet, you'll learn all their language. I thought that was the only language in the game. So I thought, oh, I'm fluent in Covex. I know 80-some words or something like that. And then I go to like a... go to like a Thrycreen planet or whatever, and it's like, oh my god, I don't know anything again. I have to. So it's kind of neat that there are three different languages.
Yeah, I like that. I like the language aspect of it. So, do you have any more tips? I don't have any more pressing questions. Do you, Drew?
Not really. No.
Dying?
just in the last 20 minutes, I've learned loads about this game, which I'm gonna.
Yeah, me.
Oh, that's good. I'm glad to help. And I think the people who were ultimately listening to this show, I think they'll get a lot out of it. I mean, because, God, I wish somebody had done this for me. Because, believe me, I spent... I almost quit the game when I said, oh, my God, all of my slots are in the wrong place. But, I have a couple other tips if you guys want me to just go over them real quick. I mean, it'll help folks out. Far away destinations, that's a big... one. Shelly, you were telling me about that, where like you found an ancient ruin or something and you wanted to get to it on your planet and you were and it was like 30 minutes away. If it's more than 20 minutes away in your ship, you can use physics to your there's these new airplanes that they're inventing that that in real life that go up into the stratosphere and come back down, and you're supposed to be able to go from like England to like New York in like an hour or something like that. The game actually supports that. So if something's more than say 20 minutes away, go to 90 degrees, go up into space. And then and then travel to it from the stratosphere and then go back down. You can actually cut your time off significantly by doing that. I don't know why it works, but it apparently works in real life too. So you can also use your pulse engine from space and it'll go faster. You can even use your jump engine.
That's what I've been doing, because if you're off planet and you see the marker that you're looking for and you aim at it and then use your pulse drive, if you're far enough out in space, it will just take you on a direct line to that, and you will sort of make planet fall right above it.
Yep.
I did that yesterday. Yeah, it was good.
That's a good one. Harsh planets. Mining on harsh planets. If you have to find, like, I don't think your home planet qualifies, Shella, but if you go to these planets that have that are really, really harsh, you guys will know when you find one. Believe me, you'll actually get a warning from your suit that'll say incoming storm or whatever.
Yeah, I was on one of those for like all of 5 minutes. I got what I needed and I got the hell out of Dodge.
Those are tough planets. Those planets are also where they keep the biggest, most valuable minerals in the game. So if you do a search for them, they actually come up as green explanation points in your when you do a scan. And those are like the purple. If you see them on the galactic thing, they're like listed as purple. Those are the planets where you find those minerals. So if you find a harsh planet, load up on whatever protection you need. Probably radiation, but it could be heat as well.
Yeah.
I guess it's possible. I haven't found a cold planet that's really violent yet, but I'm sure there are ones.
Yeah.
Load up with the right kind of protection. Chain them together.
Don't forget to chain people.
Yeah, just chain everything together, and then basically just hop out of your ship and run and mine as much as you can.
Make a cave.
Run back to your ship, or make a cave, right? So that's cool. That's how you get those. You need those elements to make some of the most advanced components in the game, so eventually you'll need them.
You'll have to go on a harsh planet. Okay.
And then the last one I have is... just one more. The mining tool cooldown. The cooldown in this game is really weird. So my mining tool is designed so that I have a lot of cooling elements into it. So I can hold the mining beam down for a long time, but eventually it's going to overheat. So what you'll do is you'll see the heat bar moving up to from 0 to 100, and then when it gets to 100, it'll flash red for a little while. And if you keep holding the mining beam down, eventually it'll say it's too hot, and you have to wait like 10 seconds for your beam to cool down. Instead of doing that, what you do is you hold the beam down. When it gets to red, you leave up on it for like half a second. It'll start to crawl back down to zero, then immediately pull the trigger again to start it up. It'll reset immediately to zero.
Oh, right. So as long as you don't wait for it to fill up fully, it'll be much quicker.
As long as it doesn't trigger its own cooldown, you can wait half a second and immediately start mining. Depending on your multi-tool, you can get into a rhythm. So I had one, like a lower end multi-tool, it would overheat every like 5 seconds. So I would just go count 1001, 1002, 1003, 1004, 1005, leave up for a half a second, pull the trigger again, and you can keep mining. You can pretty much keep mining constantly until your battery runs out. So do that. It'll make it a much more efficient. It's hard enough to get credits in this game, so that's a way to do it a little bit quicker.
Yeah.
Cool.
Agreed.
That's some good tips there. One thing I was going to ask, and maybe we can do a show. I don't know if Drew will still be playing it back there, but in like 6 months or something to see. But I was wondering, what do we think of, like, what's the future of No Man's Sky? I mean, are the updates going to be free? I certainly hope they are, are they going to have, like, expansions? Is it going to be like an MMO in terms of update?
I don't possibly see how they could expand it. I mean, I could be wrong, but it already is infinite.
Well, I don't mean expansions in as like making the world bigger. I mean just like adding content.
I'd be interested to see what they could actually do. You can certainly see that there's room for laying a sort of DLC story campaign on top of it or something. But that would really be, without changing the sort of underlying mechanics of the game, you would still just be putting more plot nodes on top of the game itself. I'm not sure how they're going to improve it significantly without sort of significant changes to the underlying mechanics of it. It just feels like a very hard game to sort of expand upon.
Right, yeah. Oh, that is disappointing, because I just assumed, because it's just so minimalist.
Yeah.
They have put out, I think they're on patch 7 now, but I think most of the patches have been gameplay related. Like the one that I noticed that I really so glad they did was, have you guys tried to target birds yet?
I try to scan them because, for my museum.
Right.
All right.
I spent half an hour basically bird watching, trying to get these birds.
So the latest patch, I think, changed that so that your scanner is a little bit more forgiving.
I read that today, you can now.
Because I noticed that.
Go back.
I was
get them birds.
Yeah, I always get to where it's only one animal left, and when I've done a planet and there's like one animal left, I'm like, it's a bird. It's got to be a freaking bird. And
Right.
so I found the bird and I'm like, okay, it's going to take me, like you say, about a half hour. And I targeted it and it immediately went into my database. So I'm like, oh my God, they patched
Oh,
it.
right.
Thank God.
That patch. Oh, okay,
Let me
cool.
give you a
Yeah.
quick, one more quick tip about that, though, which you might not like, but your scanner will actually scan dead animals. So
Oh.
if you can't hit the if you can't get the bird scanned, shoot it down and scan its body.
Wow, there's no prime directive with you then, John.
I just don't have the time. I'm like, you want to zigzag here? Eat my mining laser. And I'll scan your body.
You're Borg and Drew is, I don't know. He can't.
No, I'm going to be doing the same thing.
You're Kirk, aren't you?
Well, Drew's armed with all these tips now. Maybe he can go back and have a little bit more fun
with it.
Do you
think you'll give it another go,
I think,
Drew?
I will, yeah. I'm trying to think when I'll have time. But, yeah,
yeah.
Definitely go back to it and see if I can find some of the stuff that I've been missing.
Cool.
Yeah. Okay. So, that was No Man's Sky, I
yep.
think. Pretty much. I think I'd maybe I like it definitely more than Drew.
Yeah. And I complain a lot, but I don't dislike the game.
It's a really interesting thing.
It's just it's not really for me. And yeah.
Yeah, I'm quite surprised that I like it because I was talking to my friend Graham, who writes video games, and he's like, he was on Twitter and he said, yeah, everyone's saying No Man's Sky is boring. He's like, but as a boring dude, I'm really enjoying it. And then we had a conversation about, and I was like, I like to think it's meditative. And he's like, yeah, exactly. It's like, I usually don't like these types of games, but I'm really enjoying this. So.
Ooh, no.
John's fat phone is going.
Oh, sorry about that. Keep going.
Oh, okay. You've got citizens to save and stuff like that, John, probably.
No, absolutely. Yeah, I have my own bat symbol, but it's...
So let us know what you think of No Man's Sky, and if you've got any tips, please, add them to the comments and share.
Yeah.
Share your tips with everybody. We all need them. Thanks for coming in, Drew. John, and Drew as well.
No, I always love coming on your guys' show. Thanks so much for having me.
Yeah, and like this has been the first one we've done together, so yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, it was good having a trio, and yeah, thanks for being our guide through No Man's Sky.
Sherpa.
Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely. Happy to do that. Maybe my pain will make your journey a little bit easier.
What a noble goal.
Just can but hope. Okay. I think we'll call it there. See you, John.
See
you. Cheerio. Thank you for listening. If you have enjoyed this episode of Are You the Toss, and why wouldn't you? You can find us on iTunes. Just search for Are You the Toss. You can also find our RSS feed on our main page at gameindustry.com. If you don't use iTunes and you use another podcast player, that should work fine with it.
We're also on SoundCloud. Look for Are You the Toss. Our host, of course, is gameindustry.com. So you can talk to us via the Twitter page there, which is @GinLounge. You can also find us on YouTube, and Game Industry News is also on Facebook, on Google+, and all those good social media things. So give us a thumbs up, give us a like, tell us what you like. It's awesome. You're awesome for listening. Thank you so much.
Nailed it.